Well, it's 7 o'clock, right on. So, and I do want to remind everybody, the ones in the back will be called on. And that was what we decided now, and the elders are going to support me in that. So I think. So, except for Kevin, right? No. I'll try not to call on anybody. But I do appreciate all of you guys who have kind of moved up. And again, you can move back to the back as soon as class is over. Get your seat back again. So. Let's pray together before we start. Father in heaven, we're so thankful for you, and we're thankful to be here and an opportunity to open your word. Help us as we look at this book, specifically these verses, that we apply them, that we look at them and see the great hope that we have, and we understand the blessing of life. We understand the blessing of being here, the opportunity in this congregation here, and most of all, though, the blessing of knowing your son Jesus and what he's done for us. Lord, especially we pray for those struggling, the long list of those that are close to our hearts, and they're hurting and brokenhearted in so many different ways. Lord, I ask you to be with Faye Roberts right now as she's struggling with her sibling or brother who's not doing well in South Carolina. And Lord, we pray that you can be with all the family that's gathered around him, the doctors and nurses, and Faye also, as she keeps memories close to her heart as he's getting close to the end. And we pray that you can be with all of them and continue to be with Faye. Lord, be with Demetra and so many others on our long list of prayers that you know. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So we're in chapter 1. And whenever we get done, that's about the time we'll be finished. Right? Keep in mind, we're not going to go through every single part of 1st and 2nd Peter. As I said last time, I encourage you, though, to do that at home if you get a chance to. Anything that we don't go through, or you want to write some things down. There's a broken man behind the pages in this book. And we talked about that last week a little bit. Someone said last week, after class, he said, there's a lot of Peter in all of us. And I love that, because it's what I love about this text. We aren't looking at powerful people who were perfect. We get to look at Peter, who was imperfect, and see everything through all this. And so, of course, the going theme, what's the going theme through all of 1 Peter? Encouragement. What else? What's the going theme? Say it louder. I heard somebody say it. Hope. Hope. So keep that in mind. Hope is like water to a fish, if you want to look at it that way. And I agree. So the greeting here is important. We choose to greet people different ways. We write a letter or a card or something, and we say, dear so-and-so, or whatever. And that's how we typically do it. The author here identifies himself at the beginning, and you probably knew that. But they also greeted people years ago. In the text here, with a holy kiss. You remember that? And probably on the forehead, as they might think. I'm really glad that we don't do that, especially with some of you. But I have been kissed by Willie Franklin. Some of you have too. I think he's the only one that could get away with it. But inside this greeting, there's a few things that I don't want to skip over. So let's read this, just the first couple of verses there. Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ, to those who reside as aliens scattered through Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, Bithynia, who are chosen, according to the foreknowledge of God the Father, by the sanctifying work of the Spirit, that you may obey Jesus Christ and be sprinkled with his blood, may grace and peace be yours in fullest measure. We're going to be covering kind of verses 1 through 9 tonight. I'm kind of just going to do this in sections. And in this greeting, as I said, there's things I don't want to skip over. And somebody said and kind of summarized these first few verses and like this, and I really like this. God's been working on a plan from the beginning to save all of mankind. I want you to remember that. God's been working on a plan from the beginning to save all of mankind, and it's motivated by his love for us. It's motivated by his through his son, Jesus Christ, and that's how this plan operates. So God destined people to be his children. In 1987, I was 10 years old. I know some of you are like, what? I was 10, and we were living in Fort Collins, Colorado. And I was staying with, off and on, my Aunt Cherie lived just down the street, and so we were over at her house a lot, you know, cousins, first cousins, and the whole family, and it was my mom's sister, so we were there a lot, and I was staying with Aunt Cherie, and someone from church said, well, they're going to pick us up and in a van and take us to a movie. And I remember excited about that, and there's seats in the van, and she's going to come by and get us and pick us up. And I remember she had this really long driveway that went out to the street, and I come just blaring out that door excited about this trip to the movies, and I trip and fall, I mean, just about as hard, and I had shorts on, just about as hard as a kid can fall, okay? And I completely skinned off. I still have a big scar on my knee, just a real big scar on my knee. And I skinned off. I mean, it was completely white for a long time, if that tells you anything. It's just meat. And I had big feet at the time, and I still do. But I busted up my knee, and my Aunt Cherie, she was the sweetest ever. And if you know somebody that just oozes sweetness, that's the way she was, okay? She's an amazing lady, and just... you just ooze it. And some people here are like that. I don't really ooze it, I guess. But just being at her house, I felt like I was sweeter. All right? That's how sweet she is. And she runs out to me, and she kind of picks me up. And I'm holding my knee as tight as possible. I remember just bawling my eyes out, crying so loudly. The van's sitting out there. The lady's out there from church. And the van's sitting out there running. And all the kids are in the van. What was my aunt telling me? Let's get some comments. What else? It'll be all right. What else? Say that again. You gotta get up. Okay, what else? I mean, think about it. You're helping a 10-year-old. He's crying his eyes out. Don't cry. What else? Sharing the pain. What about looking ahead a little bit? Somebody mentioned it's going to be all right. What else are we going to say? It'll stop hurting. What, there was something that was making me cry a little bit harder. Huh?
I'll take you.
Take me where? Okay. Along the side with that. Somebody else. You can still go. It's okay. And I remember her telling me, it's okay. You're still going to get to go. I want you to remember that as we go through this. Peter here starts off, and he, according to the foreknowledge of God the Father. And let's kind of circle for a second. I don't know if you circle in your Bibles, but I have circled. We are chosen according to the foreknowledge of God the Father. When we speak about those who are chosen, here in the first part of the text, we're talking about those who are the elect. We talk about that word. That's one of the words that Peter uses. Flip over to Ephesians chapter 1 and verse 4. Just as a supporting verse. Ephesians chapter 1 and verse 4. Let's start in verse 3. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places in Christ, just as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and blameless before him. In love, he predestined us to adoption as sons through Jesus Christ to himself, according to the kind intention of his will, to the praise of the glory of his grace, which he freely bestowed on us in the beloved. This initiates way back in the call of Abraham, you remember, and his descendants. But what does that mean? Well, elect according to the foreknowledge of God. Is salvation conditional? And the answer is, somebody says, well, is salvation conditional? The answer is yes. It's conditional upon our obedience. Don't forget that. Salvation is conditional upon our obedience. God decided about sonship through Jesus Christ. And we know from Acts chapter 10 that God is no respecter of persons. In 10:34, God wants everyone to be saved. He wants 1 Timothy 2:4, he wants all men to come to the knowledge of truth. He wants everyone to be saved. Don't forget that. That's really important. If personal predestination is true, and some of you might be like, what is he talking about? We're kind of getting there. If personal predestination is true, it's where God chooses specific people to be saved or condemned beforehand. And this makes our God out to be an arbitrary God or prejudicial. And God's no respecter of persons. The predestination taught in the Bible is a class or a group of those predestined. He chose all of us before the foundation of the world to be saved. And the word here that's a key that I think sometimes we forget or we kind of skip through is the Greek word eis, which is ice. And if you look at this, it says unto obedience. And that's pretty important. So obedience must be hinged in choosing anyone before the foundation of the world. So that election brings a new relationship with the Father. You notice the word Father is used there, and it's Father. There's a relationship with God. All this according to the foreknowledge of God. Here, what is it by? Well, you look in the text and you say, well, it's by, according to, or by the sanctifying work of the Spirit. Unto obedience. And we see the word chosen sometimes, and we're like, wait a second. I don't understand. These were people whom God had chosen. But don't misunderstand me. The church, the Lord's church, must continue to be the chosen extension, if you will, spiritual extension of Israel. And we can't forget that we are the chosen of God. So it's not like that we're going to sit still and let God choose who, you know, and not do anything. And some maintain that God has chosen a direct number of people to be saved for eternity, and that's making God into something he's not. Okay? It's conditional upon our obedience. God, like I said, God is no respecter of persons. That would make God arbitrary and prejudicial. And I want to make that point clear in the beginning. We don't. That's not something that we want to just skip through. And Truth for Today commentary quotes Howard Marshall, and he says it this way. It's a way of saying God took the initiative in bringing the church into being. God took the initiative in bringing the church into being. So we can't forget it's according to the foreknowledge of God the Father, sanctified by the work of the Holy Spirit. So the Holy Spirit, and there the Spirit dwells in the life of every Christian. Acts chapter 2 and verse 38. Acts 5:32 is given to them that obey. And I just said the word it for the Holy Spirit. I do that a lot. He is given to them that obey. So to explain this better, let's talk about the opposite for a second of what the theme is. We mentioned the theme is hope. Let's talk about the opposite. What's the opposite of hope? What else? Despair. I mean, just think. Utter. Okay, despair. Good. Chaos. I want you to imagine. Take away hope. What would we be reduced to? What would we, he mentioned despair, depression. You think people are depressed now? Take away hope. You think, you know, we preached on it not too long ago, but take away the reason that you have to live. Take Peter, for example. He's a strong-willed, courageous, impetuous, making promises that with his mouth that his body can't keep, if you understand that. That's Peter. He's, I'm going to do this. I'm impetuous. That's the word. And hope is what brought him out of that. And he said, remember in Luke 22, he said, Lord, I'm ready to go with you both to prison and to death. I'm kind of like that. Maybe we would be the same way. But hopelessness, think about that. No home, without a place to belong. And do a study of the word living. It's a great study. What about born into or begat? What a great study. Born again. Our living hope is based on the resurrection of Christ. What they were going through, and we could say this to all of us today, what you are going through is not the end. It's not the end. That's what my Aunt Cherie was telling me. It's okay. It's not the end. Get up and be tough. No. So, you know what I think, though? That's the greatest thing we have, isn't it? It's the greatest thing we have. In fact, it's the greatest thing that we can be provided with, as Rusty's talking about. You have a living hope. And what we're going through is not the end of the story. Secondly, our inheritance is permanent. Look at verse 3 and 4. A living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead to obtain an inheritance which is imperishable. What does that mean? An imperishable inheritance. Never ever ends. And the Greek suggests it's, that's what I like about the Greek. When you look at the Greek, you'll learn something that you might not have realized before. And the Greek says, hand it all out, distribute that to everybody. That's what the Greek word says. Make sure and distribute that to everybody. Why? Because we need to know that. It's not going anywhere. Well, that what we have hope in through Jesus Christ is not going to go anywhere. It's permanent. And it's not only, what's your favorite word in that text? Mine is reserved. Reserved for you in heaven. Nothing can diminish it. Now let's get a few answers. What would that mean to the suffering? Nothing can diminish it. What does that mean to people who are really, really hurting? Anybody? Hope. That's how strong it is, isn't it? Look at chapter 1 and verse 5. Who are protected, this is point number 3, who are protected by the power of God through faith. Kept by the power of God. And if you look at this term, it's suggesting soldiers thrown around the faithful to protect and guarantee their safety. It's the word, I can't think of the word, is it garrison? Garrisoned around, and the present tense is suggesting that it's action right now. It's present. Garrisoned around them, that they remain in the faith. Let's turn to flip over to Jude for a second. I'm going to show you a passage in Jude, maybe you remember. Jude 21. Jude 21, keep yourselves in the love of God. Wow. Keep, that's that word, keep yourselves in the love of God, waiting anxiously for the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ to eternal life. I wish somebody could remind me that when I'm about 85. Keep yourself, wait anxiously for the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ to eternal life. Man. So we go back to here in Peter, and it says, protected by the power of God. That's heaven's, if you look at it that way, that's heaven's lock and key, isn't it? It's kept. It will not be lost in the process of any of the suffering that we go through. No disease can take it away. Nothing, no cancer can take it away. You will see him as he is. As John said. So no matter what happens on this earth, it will not change the inheritance above. But also notice how it's kept by the power of God through faith. Through faith. Salvation is having, and this word salvation here is not, sometimes salvation is having to do with past sins. This word here of salvation is talking about in front of you. A future salvation which is yet to come. To the saints when Jesus comes. Let's turn to Romans 8 for a minute. Romans 8:18. one of my favorite verses, Romans 8:18, "For I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory that's to be revealed in us. For the anxious longing of the creation waits eagerly for the revealing of the sons of God." And he goes on, he talks about waiting and groaning. Some think back in 1 Peter, he's talking about there that protected by the power of God through the faith, ready to be revealed in last time, that he's talking about, you know, you can never ever fall away. That's actually the opposite of what he's trying to say. You must have the desire and the faithfulness and the trust. Point number 4, verse 7. This is kind of the development of your faith, if you look at it that way. The proof of your faith, he says, "The proof of your faith being more precious than gold, which is perishable." The trial of your faith. You can look at it that way. He compares approved faith and gold. What are the similarities? What are the differences? Perishable, imperishable. And Peter uses the word precious. We use precious, we say children are precious. We kind of reserve that word, and Peter reserves it here. The word precious is used in chapter 1 and verse 7, chapter 1 and verse 19, chapter 2 and verse 4, chapter 2 and verse 7, and 2 Peter chapter 1 and verse 4. He likes different words, and he repeats them, and the word precious is precious to Peter, if you look at it that way, because it's a great price, it's prized, it's valuable. Precious. But who's precious? What's precious? What's precious?
Faith.
Faith. The faith is precious. So suffering also develops our faith, if you look at it that way. So as you look back on your trials that you went through in life, or you may be going through right now, they reveal sometimes that we're helpless, and we are, but we're not hopeless. If we started listing off the different trials and, you know, adversity, struggles that we've gone through in our life, whatever it is, do you think everybody here would probably have some? I think everybody here, and some that list is really, really long, and they're hurtful, and they're hard to hear, and what does it teach us? Well, it also teaches us to put our arms around people when they're going through things like that, and to uplift them and to encourage them. Those who are hurting and those who are broken. Like on the driveway, when I skin my knee, remind others they still have a hope. Let's keep continuing. Fifthly, the Savior that we can't see. Wait a second. Why is Peter reminding people of a Savior that they can't see in their time of suffering? I mean, some people might, what in the world? Why? Flip over to John 20 for a second. John chapter 20 and verse 29. Thomas answered and said to him, "My Lord and my God," in verse 28. Jesus said to him in verse 29, "Because you have seen me, have you believed? Blessed are they who did not see and yet believed." Let me ask you this question. Can you love someone you can't see? I knew an elder in the church in Colorado who's completely blind, okay? Completely blind. One of the great elders I knew as a kid, and he just had one of those sticks in front of him, and I probably told you about him before. You go out to his house, and he had cables everywhere in his acreage. Go out to feed the cattle with cables. Can you imagine that? And he would just put his hand around the cable all the way out there to the trough and feed the cows and put it back on there and walk all the way back to the house. All over his property, you see these cables everywhere. And he had children. Could he love his children? Can someone love someone they can't see? You see, and that's the, one of the great arguments of the atheists is, which, well, you can't love something you can't see. Well, that's false. You can. And here he reminds them that you have a Savior here, and they wanted to see with their own eyes, just like that's the whole reason idols grew and grew, because they wanted to touch and grasp and have and something in their hands. And he reminds them, and he says, in this you greatly, what? Rejoice. How does suffering remind us of the joy that's to come? How does suffering remind us of the joy that's to come? Anybody? Because we have hope. And when you take that away, we lose everything. I love this passage, and I hope you see the process here. You rejoice with a hope and a joy that's unspeakable. Unspeakable. It says in verse 8, and though you have not seen him, you love him. And though you don't see him now, you believe in him. You greatly rejoice with a joy inexpressible and full of joy. There's a lot of things in our life that are inexpressible. We think everything should be expressed. We live in a now, everybody express everything. And we, I look at an expressible, inexpressible joy. How do you describe that? When one day, when my wife passes away, or a family member passes away, or a father or mother of mine passes away because of cancer or whatever, and they're letting that last breath go. And they're faithful, and you know they're a child of God. Unspeakable joy. You know when you're just quiet because you know, and you just take a deep breath? Unspeakable joy. This text is powerful, and I really, as I look back, and this one with this story of my aunt in the driveway, I want to kind of bring that back and around. I remember how badly it felt that I was thinking in my mind, I'm not going to get to go where I wanted to go. I'm in pain. I'm bleeding everywhere. It's horrible at 10 years old. And then having somebody to come and comfort you, to wrap her arms around you and say, you're still going to get to go. It's okay. That's what Peter's telling them. Though you are suffering in some of the worst kind of, and as Rusty's talking about, they're dispersed, they're spreading out the churches, and they're maybe losing everything, losing hope. So I want to ask you a few questions just in closing. How did you cope when you were helpless? Is there some way that when you're suffering that helps you get through? I want anybody that wants to share.
Prayer.
Prayer. Excellent.
Pray for the person persecuted.
Excellent.
Friendship.
Friendship. That's why we're here. But God is in control, Ron said. What helped you get through it? You know, I don't think we don't get to, in an auditorium setting, I know it's hard, but we don't get to share with each other what gets you through. What gets, and Bible study, and looking at passages such as this, and how does appreciating our salvation help with giving us hope? Well, it's everything. So, what prevents us from being joyful in trials? Hope. If you don't have hope, and we don't talk about it enough, I'll be honest, I haven't taught a lot of youth classes on hope. I think that's where we need to start. Let's continue to teach our young people to rely on the hope that we have through Jesus Christ. Any other comments? Anybody want to share? Let's pray together. Father in heaven, we're so thankful for this study. We're thankful for Peter and what he's writing and challenging them with and us with to hold on to hope, to hold on to what we know what's ahead, and what we wait eagerly, we wait in patience, and we know what's coming, and we know what you've told us and in your promises, and we're thankful for your son Jesus, that he came, lived, and died, and rose again, and is alive, and we're grateful for that chance that we have, that we're not hopeless, that we're not despaired, that we have that anchor of hope within us. And thank you for the reminder that Peter reminds us with tonight, and be with us all to hold on to that every single day, every single moment. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Next week, we're going to talk more about holiness.